The Infinite Monkey Cage presents How to Build a Universe, Part 1, by Professor Brian Cox, Robin Ince, and Alexandra Feachem.
I'm not sure about the title, actually.
No, I'm not sure about it either. We had a lot of debates about this, didn't we? Because I'm not entirely sure that, after reading this, you will be able to build a universe, because what I've got in my back garden is a right old mess.
I suppose that's why it's part one. It's kind of an introduction to building a universe, although there's very little, I agree, about building a universe in it.
It's got some practical hints, but I don't believe you'll be able to get a full universe, but you should be able to get, I hope, your own singular cellular life form by the end of it.
Do you think? This book is dedicated to our very own infinite monkeys.
Ever, George and Archie. Anyway, so we'll start the Monkey Cage book with a beginning, and we have a very special forward, and you got Eric Idle to write this, didn't you?
Yeah, we're very good friend. I think, actually, if I ring him up, I think he'll do it. Well, he will do it. He'll do it for me.
Okay, he'll great. Great to have Eric Idle at the beginning of the book. Yeah.
Right. I'll turn it off touch tone so that people can't work out his number.
Yeah.
Hello? Hello, Eric?
Hello?
Is that Eric?
Who's this?
It's Brian.
Brian who?
Brian Cox.
You're the actor?
Oh, no, I'm the other one.
Oh, the other one. How's that going?
It's going very well indeed. It's going finding out new secrets of the universe as we speak.
But and you can never keep them. That's the thing about you, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah. Listen, Eric, we're recording the audiobook for The Infinite Monkey Cage, How to Build a Universe, and you were kind enough to write an introduction. Would it be possible for you to read your introduction for the audiobook?
That's not an introduction, that's a warning. I don't want people being seduced into buying this book just because they have my dulcet tones on the recording.
Oh, right. Well, so the answer's a no, then.
Well, anyway, good luck with the whole book enterprise thing. You know, we started that Christmas book, I did, actually, in about 1969 or 70, with Monty Python's Big Red Book, and a jolly good thing it was, too, because we sold thousands of copies to the unsuspecting British public.
Is it still available?
No.
Well, thank you very much, Eric Idle.
Well, you're very welcome, Brian Cox.
All right, then, well, we'll have to do the forward then.
That didn't sound very nice.
You said you're friends with him.
Didn't go well at all, did it?
Right. Hello. Sorry to come barging into this pseudo-scientific book, but obviously publishers are greedy bastards and will do anything they can to try and seduce the gullible public into buying enormous quantities of meretricious trash for the Christmas. Did you read this before he...
No, he just said that he was a big fan and he'd write something really, you know, wonderful, filled with praise, he said.
Did he say he was a big fan of the Infinite Monkey Cage? Or did he say he was a big fan of the Life Scientific?
I don't know, actually.
Right, okay.
Carry on, anyway. It'll get better. I'm sure it'll get better.
So I've been asked to lend my name to this blatant attempt to part you from your cash. What is The Infinite Monkey Cage anyway? Apart from being a terrific song written and sung by yours truly, I knew he'd bring that up, with every single instrument played by Jeff Lynn, and certainly something you should try to download for Christmas. But no, it's the sodding BBC, and it's not available, or they'd have to pay something. That's why you're stuck with this book. Friends, yeah? Okay.
Yeah,
I think you'll find it very helpful. It's useful for keeping a door propped open or to put on your Christmas table to stop the hot plates blistering the plastic tablecloth. But do watch out for the Christmas pud. The book itself is highly flammable, and if it catches, you might possibly set fire to an elderly aunt. On the other hand, if you are cold, simply stick it in the grate and it will make a lovely Christmas blaze. As you know, the scientists are the new chefs. So, pity poor Ince, once a halfway decent...
Pity poor Ince, once a halfway decent comedian, now stuck alongside a glamour boy professor, playing Robin to his Batman.
Well, at least he didn't put professor in inverted commas.
No. Still, if it stops him having to play Colchester again, I suppose the whole thing's been worth it.
I'm playing Colchester next Tuesday. One or two words about the monkey cage itself. Is the cage infinite, or are the monkeys infinite? Or perhaps they're both infinite? In a multiverse, would there be an infinite donkey cage? I think we should be told. Well, that's about it. I shall be spending my Christmas day in the traditional way on a Thai massage table, listening to the sounds of the 70s. Sadly, we don't get the Queen's speech here in Bangkok, but there are one or two compensations. There's an inspirational message from Jose Marino and a bottle of gluten-free almond wine for ancient teetotaling ex-pythons sent by John Cleese from his cellars, where he hangs upside down during the winter season. To all of you, please enjoy your expanding universe for another year, and do try to buy more Monty Python shit. We haven't got long, and we do need the cash. Happy Christmas greetings. Eric Idle, The Old Jokes Home, Thailand. Well, it's not the most auspicious start to a book, is it? Let's get on to the first chapter.
A Word from the Producer. The Producer's Tale by Sasha Feachem. Hello, I'm Sasha. I produce the radio show The Infinite Monkey Cage. I say produce, I use the term loosely. You'll understand why in a moment. Brian thought it would be a good idea if I wrote something about what it's like to work with him and Robin. I'm not sure he had fully thought through that suggestion when he made it. I responded with hysterical enthusiasm. Brian looked scared, perhaps punching the air and shouting, "Yes! Finally the world will hear my story," was a nanometer over the top.
Brian's footnote.
A nanometer is 10 to the minus 9 metres. That's 1 billionth of a metre. This sentence implies that Sasha went around 10 helium atom diameters over the line of acceptable excitement.
Despite this, and trying desperately to hide his alarmed expression behind a nervous smile, Brian realised that retracting the suggestion was clearly not an option, that the horse or monkey keeper had well and truly left the infinite zoo enclosure at something approaching the speed of light. So here I am, with the producer's tale, to tell you how the Infinite Monkey Cage evolved into existence and what it's like to work with the infinite monkeys. And although the title of the show was in no way chosen to reflect the personalities of the people involved or the way the radio show is put together, there is no doubt that we have all gloriously grown into the title. Thank goodness we didn't call it Top Geek. Back in 2008, CERN switched on the mother of all science experiments, the Large Hadron Collider. It is still the longest, fastest, most expensive science experiment ever undertaken. A particle smasher of biblical proportions, it recreates the moment just a billionth of a second after the Big Bang, and is the ultimate testament to what happens when human beings get together and ask why and what if. And when the Large Hadron Collider did switch on, Brian and I were sitting in the control room at CERN alongside Andrew Marr, broadcasting to the nation, live on the Today programme. It was quite an odd experiment in itself, doing live coverage of a science experiment that is hidden underground and involves minuscule particles that I think even David Attenborough would fail to do justice to, especially on the radio. As Evan Davis commented from the safety of the Today studio back in London, "It's a bit like Olympic Taekwondo. It all sounds very interesting, but no one is quite sure what is actually going on." Luckily, the much-predicted black hole that had gripped the popular press did not materialise, and we all lived to tell the tale.
Brian's footnote.
By popular press, Sasha means the Daily Mail, whose headline, "Are We All Going to Die Next Wednesday?" should, if accuracy was the only goal, have led to a one-word article. No.
And of course, just a few years later, this extraordinary machine discovered the elusive Higgs particle, and with it gave us the origin of mass and opened a whole new chapter in our quest to understand the universe we live in. But perhaps the most extraordinary achievement of this jaw-dropping experiment was the interest it ignited in the general public. Suddenly, incredibly, science was cool. Not just science, but particle physics. Some very well-known voices and faces emerged from the shadows and declared themselves fans of physics. Science had become, dare I say it, a little bit rock and roll, and so the idea for the Infinite Monkey Cage was born. Brian had told me some hilarious tales about celebrities he'd encountered on his travels, from dinners with Dan Aykroyd to finding himself in a hotel suite with Cameron Diaz and Queen Noor of Jordan, all fans of particle physics, not just Brian's hair. One of Brian's friends told us that we should try to get hold of Mick Jagger. He's way up on this shit, apparently. What could be more rock and roll than that? Mick, if you're listening to this, we'd still love to hear from you. Robin, at this point, was regularly performing and curating his hugely popular stand-up shows, mixing scientists with comedians, and so this odd idea of a Radio 4 panel show featuring scientists and celebrities was born. Robin came up with the title, and now, nearly 10 years later, it doesn't seem like such an odd idea to have comedian Katie Brand on stage with Professor Carlos Frank, one of the world's most esteemed cosmologists, or Ross Noble sitting alongside an expert in early human fossils, or even a python, Monty, and a geologist. But I think the moment when I seriously began to believe in the possibility of parallel universes was the first time we took to the stage at Glastonbury in 2011, to be greeted by the deafening cheers of more than 3,000 people. These rock festival goers, most of them still probably the worse for wear from the night before, had stampeded across fields of mud to cram into the cabaret tent at the most famous music festival in the country to see a comedian and a physicist take to the stage to talk about rationality, evidence, and the wonders of science. "Who's here for particle physics?" shouted Robin. The 3,000 people screamed back. "Quantum chromodynamics," shouted Brian, to even more enthusiastic cheers. "It's not very Radio 4, is it?" observed Brian. "Not very Radio 4, and not, some might argue, very sciencey. But why shouldn't it be?" One of the most frequent complaints we get to the radio programme, usually I have to say from people who've never listened, is that we are dumbing down science. Have you heard one of Brian and Robin's introductions? I'm sorry, but "Yo mama's so fat she's redshifted" has got to be one of the most highbrow jokes ever heard on Radio 4. You need a PhD in astronomy to really keel over laughing at that one. The rest of us just sit and look a bit baffled, although we very much enjoy watching Brian giggling away, and we feel happy that we know the joke might be funny once we've had a chance to go home and do some homework.
Brian's footnote.
This experience will be familiar to anyone who's been in the audience at one of Robin's stand-up gigs.
To accuse the show of dumbing down science is to fundamentally misunderstand its purpose and the real reason why we all feel so passionately about its central message. Science is arguably the single biggest force in culture today. Cloning, genetic modification, nuclear power, the web, modern medicine, you name it, science is changing our world. Turn your back on science and you turn your back on the future and you fail to understand the present. To be truly engaged in society, everyone needs a basic grasp of what science is about and the way of thinking that leads to the advances that we all take for granted. Science is vitally important and therefore it must be part of popular culture. Why would anyone want to leave the foundation of our society to the boffins? They're just people after all. They laugh, they cry, they watch Love Island like the rest of us.
Brian's footnote.
I don't even have to say it, do I?
And comedians and entertainers read books and newspapers, use hospitals and drive cars, and take an interest in the world around them. And in some cases had whole careers in quantum physics or cosmology before being lured away by the thrill of treading the boards. Hello, Ben and Dara. What I love most about working on the show is that in mixing these amazing people together and putting a comedian and a physicist in charge, you never quite know what you're going to get. It's chaotic and anarchic and a little bit terrifying if you're the producer, and possibly if you're the listener too. But whatever the outcome, it's always interesting and surprising, and most of all, we hope it makes people think. Brian and Robin really are the infinite monkeys, and although we may set out hoping to produce the works of Shakespeare, what emerges at the end, just like the theory we're named after, is a splendid testament to randomness. But despite the infinite chaos and the anarchic bamboozlement, I hope we are never dull and that we do the best job possible at fighting the corner for evidence, rational thinking and the glory and wonder of scientific endeavour and asking questions. After all, science allows you to write the secrets of the universe on a blackboard, and what's not to love about that?
Part 1. Number 1. Introductions and infinity.
Welcome to the Infinite Monkey Cage. Hello, I am Robin Ince.
And I'm Brian Cox.
And this is the first Infinite Monkey Cage book. There will be an infinite number. Growing up in the 1970s and 1980s, our interest in space, technology and strange undersea creatures with terrifying tentacles or the ability to eat their own brains came from a mixture of Look and Learn magazine, The $6 Million Man and Arthur C. Clarke's Mysterious World.
We were kids in the Indian summer of the space race, a little too young to remember the moon landings, but the excitement of exploration still enthused us all. I, myself, still own a Space 1999 outfit.
Well, you say still, you've had it specially made. Three of them.
Recently. Mm. Yeah. It was a time of Cold War danger and anxiety, but also of immense optimism and confidence in the promise of science and technology.
I think it says a lot that you've got a Space 99 outfit and I've got a Blake...
Space 99?
Space 99, yeah. I've got... My version of the moon just has a flake sticking out of it. That's the entire thing. All that happened was a small piece of chocolate was jettisoned off the moon.
You know, less ambitious, but still.
Yeah, more delicious. Yeah. There's not enough chocolate in Space 1999. Yeah, I've got a Blake 7 outfit, which is just like a bit of a sheep...
Flake 7.
Flake 7. Ah, oh. We should rewrite this book. It's too late now, isn't it? Now we've found the puns. Anyway, sadly, Brian couldn't ever become an astronaut because he's too tall, and I couldn't become one because I'm too chatty and short-sighted and not very patient when it comes to misbehaving machines. So there's no way Apollo 13 would have returned to Earth if I'd been in there galumphing about and kicking whatever bit of kit refused to operate as I wanted it to. I'm one of those unfortunate humans who believe that objects misbehave with the specific intention of ruining my day. I am likely to be found dead from a heart attack after a blazing row with an inanimate object, probably a plant pot.
Whilst Robin's inability to operate machinery led him to become a comedian via a degree in one or other of the humanities at some university or other, I became a particle physicist after a short detour via the music industry, although even then I was primarily interested in programming the Roland MC300 microcomposer and only transferred my interest to sex, drugs and rock and roll when my MIDI cable became frayed.
Oh, if only they could see what your eyes did when you mentioned the Roland MC300 microcomposer. Anyway, in the early 1980s, television was our teacher. Carl Sagan's Cosmos is one of the main reasons why the Infinite Monkey Cage exists. Opening with the music of Vangelis, the composer who would also score Blade Runner, a film Brian loves as he knows why he has the same dream about unicorns every night. Sagan's spaceship of the imagination travelled through the nebulae and star systems. Music fades, camera pans across a cliff face and zooms into Carl Sagan, and we 12-year-olds sat up, wide-eyed and eager, and heard the words, "The cosmos is all it is, or ever was, or ever will be." And thus, we were snared. Within minutes, we would know that we were all star stuff, that the stuff of us was the stuff of the stars. The atoms that were currently gathered to form the shape and minds of us had been forged in the furnace of stellar nurseries.
Carl Sagan was a pivotal figure for us because he made vivid the link between our science and our humanity. We're part of the cosmos, Sagan told us, and our fate is deeply connected with it. Science is devalued when separated from culture.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.